Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
1 John 5 and beginning of verse number 4, "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witness in earth, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree in one." Father, we're asking your blessing tonight upon the preaching of your word. I pray that it would help us to, particularly at this time of year, to realize who you are, why you came, and what the impact is on a lost and dying world. And I pray, God, that we would be able to see that clearly tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. This morning we sang a song, "Go Tell It on the Mountain." And in that song, it tells us what we're supposed to tell. I mean, the title of it is "Go Tell It on the Mountain." But what are we supposed to tell? Well, according to the song, that Jesus Christ is born. Well, to some people, that wouldn't mean a whole lot. You know, a lot of people would just respond, "So what?" You know, matter of fact, in our materialistic society today, even those that probably know what it means, it was like, "Well, that was 2,000 years ago. Who cares? You know, Santa Claus is coming to town." But just like any birth, a birth is only a beginning. But what follows a birth is a life, and then, sadly and tragically for most, a death. I mean, that's birth and life and death. Jesus was born for a reason, and the reason that he was born was to die. Long and short of it. Not for himself, but for you and for me. In Daniel 9 and verse 26, the Bible said, "And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself." But not for himself. And that's important because many people look at the life of Jesus and think that either he did something or failed to do something that caused the authorities to snatch him out of society and nail him to a cross, when in fact he had done all things well, the Bible said, and everything that he did, all that he did pleased the Father. So there was nothing that he did. He was doing all of this for us. Isaiah 53 and verse 5 says, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." We're a sick bunch. We're a sick bunch. And in 1 John 2 and verse 1 and 2, John said, "My little children, these things write I unto you that you sin not." He said, "And if any man sin, we have an advocate." That's a lawyer. That's a representation. We have an advocate with the Father. Who is that? Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. A propitiation is just a big theological term that's used to represent a payment that satisfies. And the payment that was required, Jesus Christ satisfied. And of course, what he did was to pay our sin debt in full, and not just yours or mine, but everyone's. See, the reason why I read 1 John chapter 5 there is because it says that there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, We know that. This is a timely passage to support, at least the best way that we can with Scripture, I'm choosing my word carefully here, because to me, the Trinity is a conclusion. It's a foregone conclusion. I'm not hindered by anyone's skepticism over it because of this verse right here. He said that there are three that bear record in heaven. You have the Father and the Word and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. I don't have to be able to explain it, but it's my responsibility to believe it. And I believe what it says. Now, you can define it any old way you want, but notice it says in heaven that exists. But what about on the earth? What about when the Word came to the earth? Who is he? What is he? What's his purpose? And as I said this morning, we're being told to sing this, the praises of him. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ was born. Well, he's just another birth in the world of the billions and billions that have been born over the years. But he's a little different. He's a lot different than many people, because we were never born with a, I'm not saying that we couldn't or didn't have a purpose in, we'll say, the mind of God, but there was no purpose prior to our existence for why we came into the world. But I know this, Jesus Christ left the throne room of heaven, pre-existing coming to the earth. So he had to come for a reason, and he did. And that's what needs to be told, go tell it on the mountain, not simply that he was born. Hebrews 2:9 says, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for what? For the suffering of death. So, I mean, anyone looking for an answer to why did Jesus come? That's it right there. He came to die, long and short of it. Now, we have a difficult time trying to grasp how a loving Heavenly Father could send his Son into the world to die as a substitute for creatures like us. But he did, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. But he was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, yet crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. You want a reason. Hebrews 2:9 is the reason why Jesus came, and the benefit of mankind if they would just simply acknowledge that. But according to a spiritual song that we sang this morning, we're to tell everyone that Jesus Christ is born, but so much more needs to be told. I mean, this time of year, yeah, we know it's the birth of Christ, but if all he ever did was got born, then we're all helpless, hopeless, lost sinners. Because a little baby can't save anybody. I don't care how many times they want to make postage stamps with him sitting on Mary's lap, and everyone sticks it on their Christmas cards and everything, but a baby can't save anybody. And he was never intended to save anybody. Galatians 4, verse 4 and 5 says, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law. For what? To redeem them that were under the law. That's why. That we might receive the adoption of sons. Jesus Christ was born to die in order to redeem mankind. In 1 Peter 1, in verse 18 and 19, Bible tells us, and I believe it, for as much as ye know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. Verse 20 says, who verily is an old English word, just means truly, who truly was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. Why did he come? He came to die. He came to die, not for himself. He came to die for you and for me. And let me present to you this evening some of the things that Jesus became or was made to be for our sakes. Number one, he became flesh. He became flesh. The last stanza of Go Tell It on the Mountain goes like this. 'Twas in a humble manger that Jesus Christ was born. The God of all creation became a child that morn. He became flesh. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. But for as many spirits as might be sitting in here tonight, we can't see him. But if you cloaked him with flesh, you would be able to. And so since God became flesh, he did so that he could interact with us. In 1 John 1 and verse 14, and I think I cited this verse this morning, that the Word, the capital W Word, the same one that we read about in 1 John, that there were three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word. Well, that Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And the Bible says we beheld his glory. We wouldn't have been able to beheld his glory if he hadn't become flesh. But we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Philippians 2:7, important verse, says, he took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. Why? So that we could see him, we could interact with him, we could speak to him. Individuals that he came in contact with could relate to him. In 1 John 4 and verse 2 and 3, we read, hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. So anyone that wants to believe that Jesus Christ is not God in the flesh, they've got a problem. It says in verse 3, and every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is in the world. And so here we are, you know, in the year 2021, ready to close this out, and guess what? Things have not changed. There are still people that refuse to believe that Jesus Christ is very God in the flesh, and then there's plenty of people that that believe that he is. And those that do, that confess that he has come in the flesh, that doesn't come by intellect. It doesn't come from education. It comes from God, the Spirit of God. Remember when Jesus asked the question in Matthew 16, he said, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they came up with all kinds of things. Well, some say you're him. But he said, no. Because it doesn't really matter what somebody else thinks. Matters what you think. And that's what he said to Peter. He said, no. But who do you say that I am? And he said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He didn't say, wow, you must have really paid attention when you were in Bible college. No, he said, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. That's how it was revealed by the Spirit of God. Why? Because the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. They're foolishness to him. They can't know them because they're spiritually discerned. And so he came in the flesh. He came in the flesh for a reason. And every one of the reasons is not for himself. Hey, let's face it. I think life was pretty good for Jesus in heaven. He wasn't bored. He'd say, you know, I've been living up in heaven. This heaven business is too heavenly. I want to go down there in the earth. I want to get down. No, I don't think that was. All of it was done so that we could benefit from it. Number one, he became flesh. Number two, he made himself of no reputation. I've got news for you. He is a shining light in heaven and all over the world. Before light was even made, before the sun and the moon ever existed, there was light. And we know about, as we read through the Bible, we know that Jesus Christ is the light. And even in the future, in the New Jerusalem, there'll be no need for the sun or the moon because the Lamb is going to be the light. He's important. He shines. He's a glowing individual, if you will. But it says he made himself of no reputation. He made himself of no reputation. What does that tell us? Tells us that he has a reputation and rightly deserved. But he didn't show it. He wasn't walking around with his chest stuck out. Philippians 2 in verse 7 and 8 says, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Who would do that? Who would do that if you didn't have to or if you didn't care to do it? Remember, Jesus said, no man taketh my life from me. He said, I got power to lay it down. I got power to take it again. He did. Hebrews 5:8 tells us, though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. I don't think most people, having even for a moment, realizing that they had an out, a way of escape, would have put up with what Jesus went through. They'd have said, I'm done. Again, Hebrews 2:9, very salient verse here. But we see Jesus, and we ought to see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for what reason? For the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. He made himself of no reputation. He became flesh. He did all this for us. Number three, let me say, he became sin. These were all things that he was not in heaven as the Word, but the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And as he did that, he made himself of no reputation. He went one step further than that. He wasn't just a humble character. He became sin. I didn't say he became sinful, but he became sin. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Again, for what reason? For what purpose? For what benefit? Ours. Ours. Isaiah 53 and verse 12 says, therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Why? Because he has poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. That's why. He did that for you and for me. 1 Peter 3:18 says, for Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. Peter also says in 1 Peter 2 and verse 24, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye are healed. You know, there's something about sin that is likened unto a curse in the Bible. And the Bible tells us in Galatians 3:13, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is every one that hangeth on a tree. You talk about stepping down from glory, being the Word, being the preeminent one in all things, and to go from there and to become flesh. I mean, think about it. If you were God, like a spirit, God, and all of a sudden you came down here and it's like, ugh, what's this? I don't like this flesh. Matter of fact, a lot of times, depending upon the time of day and the amount of exertion and all that, we don't like this flesh either. But God never had any flesh to deal with. And all of a sudden, he's in it. I bet he wanted to get out, but he's all caught up in flesh. And then he makes himself of no reputation. It's just like, and then what's he do? He becomes sin for us. Did you ever think about that for a second? Go tell it on the mountain, the song says. He became flesh. He made himself of no reputation. He became sin. Number four, he made himself a high priest forever. He wasn't always, but he chose to do these things. Why? For us. He's a high priest forever. Hebrews 6 and verse 17 to 20 said, wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, it just means it doesn't change, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation. All I can think of is like in the old game shows, if you didn't win, you ended up with a, Johnny, tell them what their consolation prize is, so that people wouldn't go away feeling poorly. They would have something. Well, we have a strong consolation in what Jesus has done for us. Who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Which hope we have, not we're working for, we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth in within the veil. Whither the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus, made an high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. He is a high priest. You know what a high priest does? A lot of things, but two main things. They offer sacrifices and they intercede for the people. Jesus is that forever. He, in Hebrews 9:14, the Bible said, how much shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. He offered up the epitome of sacrifice. He offered up himself. And then to intercede for the people, Hebrews 7 and verse 25 says, wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Yeah, I would say thank you, Lord, for becoming a high priest. Not only was he doing the important job of offering the sacrifice, he was the sacrifice. How do you beat that? Made a high priest forever. Number five, in so doing, he became the author of eternal salvation. There's not a religion on the planet that can offer that, eternal salvation. Jesus can. Hebrews 5 and verse number 9 says, and being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Again, these verses in Hebrews. Hebrews 7 and verse 26 and 27 says, for such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself. He didn't have to do it again. He did it one time. Hebrews 10 and verse 10 to 12 tells us the same thing, by the which we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest standeth daily, ministering and oftentimes offering the same sacrifices, which could never take away sins. But this man, Jesus, this man, after he had offered up one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He became the author of eternal salvation. When I came to Christ, what I got was eternal. I couldn't lose it. I'm hell proof. I'm hell proof tonight. Not because of anything that I've done, because of all that he's done. No, I've got much more to say and go tell it on the mountain than Jesus Christ is born. There's so much more. Being born was just getting the ball rolling in his life here on this planet. And then let me say this, number six, and finally, he was made a surety of salvation. It'd be one thing, it'd say, well, you know, he's the author of eternal salvation, but how do we know this? Well, it says in Hebrews 7 and verse 22, by so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. You know what a surety is? It's a guarantee. It's a guarantee. Comes with the guarantee. Man, I'll tell you, you think of all of the things that go on in this world, and then you read the fine print, and it's a limited guarantee or a limited warranty or they've got all kinds of crazy terms. You need a lawyer to figure out all of read the fine print and all that stuff. But no, this comes with the guarantee. There isn't a whole lot that's guaranteed in this world, but salvation is guaranteed. It's guaranteed. It's a sure thing. Again, going to Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 18 and 19, that by two immutable things. You say, yeah, what are those? The two immutable things is what God said and what he wrote. What he said and what he wrote was, in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge. That's what we did when we realized my goose is cooked. What am I going to do? I ran to Jesus. And I ran for refuge. And what I did was I laid hold on the hope that was set before us. He said, which hope we have is an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. It's sure. It comes with the guarantee. You say, what guarantee is this? Jesus told us in John 10 and verse 27 to 30, he said, my sheep hear my voice. He said, I know them and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life and they shall never perish. I love it when somebody wants to question my salvation. I say, well, I don't know where you're coming from. All I know is that Jesus said, I give unto them eternal life and they shall never perish. He said, neither shall any man pluck them out of my Father's hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. And so I'm unpluckable. I'm in. I'm sure. I'm safe, and it's all because of what he did. Yes, by all means, the holiday season is upon us, and we sing the songs. And the song that we sang this morning was, go tell it on the mountain, Jesus Christ is born. Well, the spiritual hymn writer declares, the God of all creation became a child that morn. But I sure am glad that that wasn't all that he did. And he lived a life, 33 and a half sinless years, and it culminated with his death on a cross for you and for me.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone.